Well, good morning. Welcome to Pine Island United Methodist Church, where we exist to reach people with God's love, transform lives, and change the world. My name is Kaylee Vita. I'm the pastor here. We're thrilled that you're worshiping with us today, whether you are here in person or whether you're joining us online. As part of our Wesleyan Rooted series, I'm using different calls to worship and prayers that have been written by various United Methodists, some current, some from the past. And today, I'd like to read this prayer. It was written by Richard Allen, who was an African Methodist Episcopal bishop. It was written in the 19th century. So will you pray with me? We believe, O Lord, that you have not abandoned us to the dim light of our own reason to conduct us to happiness, but that you have revealed in holy scriptures whatever is necessary for us to believe and practice. How noble and excellent are the precepts, how sublime and enlightening the truth, how persuasive and strong the motives, how powerful the assistance of your holy religion. Our delight shall be in your statutes, and we will not forget your word. Amen. Let's worship together today.
Will you please stand? Just like last week, we're going to start this week with one of the Charles Wesley hymns. If you want to follow along, it's number 603 in your hymnal. I know we haven't done that in a long time.
Oh,
last one was new for you, but I loved it so much that I wanted you to hit home with it. So we did it a couple of times. Thank you for singing with me this morning. Take this time to greet your neighbor and say hello to a new face this morning.
Well, as you begin to make your way back to your seats, I have a few announcements for us today. First of all, today is our food and fellowship day. And so when you head over to Wesley Hall, there will be box lunches for you. The crew has made those for us today, a sandwich, some chips, I think a dessert and a piece of fruit is in there for each of us. And grab your box and then sit down at one of the round tables, and then we'll get started with our small group discussion right after that. So we'll kind of combine our small group and our food and fellowship today. So that's the plan. I hope that you can all join us for that. Our Monday night study, the last one that of this series, In the Line of Jesus, the Five Women and Their Stories, is tomorrow night, September 9th. We meet at 6:30 here in the Sunday School Room. Even if you haven't joined us for the other four studies, you could come tomorrow night. It would be fine. We finish off the study talking about Mary, Jesus' mother. So I'm sure it'll be a great discussion. All are welcome for that. And then our next Monday night study will start in 2 weeks, so September 23rd. And we're going to use a book called Fresh Air, written by one of my very favorite seminary professors, Dr. Jack Levison. He's done extensive research in the study of the Holy Spirit throughout scriptures. And this is one of his books that he's written to be a good entry-level book for people to study the Holy Spirit. It's easy to read. It's a great, great book with great discussion questions. So we'll be reading that a chapter a week. So if you plan to come, get the book. You can order it on Amazon. We are using the newest version. He just came out with a revised edition. So we are going to use that. But if you get an old copy, you'll be fine. And read the first chapter for our first night on the 23rd. So I hope that you can all join us for that. Ladies, the Women's Circle meets this Tuesday, September 10th. They meet over in the office building over in rooms 1 and 2, and this month their program will be watching and discussing the video. It's a documentary called Rediscovering God in America. So all women are welcome. Bring a friend. Come out for that. They meet at 12:30, and so bring your own lunch, and then drinks and desserts are always provided. And then finally, just a reminder about those black books that are in the pew. If you'll take a moment to sign those, let us know that you're here. Give us any information you'd like, including an email address, and we'll get you signed up for the newsletter that goes out typically on Wednesdays with a video for me and then the calendar of events of things that are happening around here. And so now, if Mo wants to come in with the kids, and any kids that are in here want to come up and join Mo, that would be fine. Come on down. We have lots of friends today. Hopefully, squeeze in.
There's so many people, I don't even know where to sit. All right. Good morning, everybody. How are you all doing today? Good, good, good. Sounds like you're all pretty tired too, right? School started pretty recently. You're all still getting used to the schedule. Well, you know the Bible, right? It's this big book. But did you know the Bible is actually not just one big book? It's lots of little books put together. Do you know that? Have you heard like the different books of the Bible, you know? Like Genesis, Exodus, you know, the Gospels, Mark, Luke. Yeah? Well, it's kind of like a library. You guys have probably been to the library. Yeah, I love the library. Well, when you go to the library, you see lots of different kinds of books. What kinds of books do you see at the library? What kinds of books? Mm-hmm. Fiction, yeah. So stories that aren't real. What else? Yeah? Nonfiction, stories that are real. What else? Any different kinds of books, like Picture books, chapter books, pop-up books, yeah. Poems, yeah. There's lots of different kinds of books at the library. And we don't read these all the same way, right? Because you're not going to read a poem the same way that you're going to read a real-life story. You're not going to read a picture book the same way you read a chapter book. And that's how the Bible is, too. There's all these different books in it, and we read them all differently, just like a library. So can we pray about that? Okay, repeat after me. Dear God, thank you so much for the Bible. We will study it like a library. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you for joining me, everybody.
Well, as I shared last week, one of the distinctive things about the United Methodist Church is that we are connectional, meaning that as local churches, we do not operate alone. Each month, every local United Methodist Church around the world gives towards 7 funds that enable ministries that make a difference. Through this sermon series, we're highlighting some of these different funds, and today I want to share about the Episcopal Fund and the Ministerial Education Fund. When Jesus sent his disciples out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal, he instructed them not to take anything with them, but rather to stay with those who welcomed them along the way. They had to rely on the grace of God shown through the people they were serving each step of the way. And as United Methodists, God graces us with leaders to guide us in faith. And in turn, we are conduits of God's grace, providing for those called to lead. The Episcopal Fund provides for the expenses of bishops and supports both retired bishops and their spouses. And the Ministerial Education Fund provides scholarships for those seeking to become clergy, supports United Methodist seminaries across the United States, and other educational opportunities for pastors in our churches. So you're invited to give today, knowing that as you do, you support people to follow their call as leaders in the faith. And there are many ways that you can give, and those are listed for you on the screen. Will you pray with me? Wonderful God, we thank you that your grace not only flows to us, but also flows through us. We thank you for the opportunity to give today and for our United Methodist family, where we provide for one another through leadership, financial support, and love. May our giving be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. playing double duty today, so he's our head usher and our prayer, so.
Okay. happy Sunday. I look forward to Sunday. I look forward to coming here to this sanctuary. Leave all that other stuff out there. Just come in here. Be together. Be with God. Dear Lord, of us all, every week we look forward to coming to this calm and gentle sanctuary. Away from the mindless bombast, the vulgar threats, the heartbreaking tragedies of the world outside. Away from our own fears and pain and exhaustion. And away from our own failures to be as you would want us to be. Here, we can be with you, with our kindred soul friends, and with our beloved pastor and teacher. Here, we can be ourselves, we can cry, pray, laugh, sing, and yes, maybe even dance a little as we sing along with our great praise team. Here, we can recharge our spiritual strength and wisdom for this coming week. And we thank you, Lord, for all of that. And in this coming week, we can show by our genuinely kind words and deeds that we actually do love your other children, even the ones we find it really hard to love. And to show by our recharged spirit and our behavior that we actually do love you, and we love being Christians, not just here in our sanctuary on Sunday morning, but every day of the week. But, oh Lord, we are only human and life can get tough. We get sidetracked, frustrated, heartbroken, weak-willed. Sometimes we get arrogant. We get exhausted. We get intimidated. Please help us to remember that we have you in our hearts and your word in our Bibles anytime, all the time. And when life gets tough and chaotic, Lord, please remind us that our Bible has, well, what I call an emergency number to help us get through any adversity, anytime, anywhere. Such as when we're enduring sorrow. There is always John 14. When others disappoint us, there is Psalm 27. When we're facing danger, there is Psalm 91. When we're in desperate need of some peace and rest, there is Matthew 11, 25 to 30. And when we're in need of strength and faith, there's Hebrews 11. And Lord, we know there are many more emergency numbers in the Bible for anything we face. All we have to do is open it up and start reading this truly amazing book. Lord, thank you for our Bible, for John and Charles Wesley, for our United Methodist Church, for our pastor and her family, and for her sermon today. May we hear it clearly and use it in our everyday lives. And may we walk out of the sanctuary today feeling stronger, more hopeful and peaceful, and ready for the week to come. And now, my friends, we're all going to join in saying the prayer Jesus taught us 2,000 years ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And all the people of God thankfully say, Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Richard, for reading our scripture this morning, and thank you, Bob, for that morning prayer. So, indoor plumbing. It came to the U.S. in the 1840s, but it didn't become widely available until the 1880s. Now, up to this point, everyone used outhouses, and the idea of having a room inside your house where you relieve yourself sounded outrageous and gross. And it wasn't just individual houses that debated whether to move the outhouse inside, but also the church. While some people were open to the idea of indoor plumbing, others thought it was unholy and indecent to go to the bathroom inside God's house. And they used a literal reading of Deuteronomy 23, 12 through 14 to argue their point. And that verse says, designate a place outside the camp where you can go to relieve yourself. As part of your equipment, have something to dig with, and when you relieve yourself, dig a hole and cover up your excrement. For the Lord your God moves about in your camp to protect you and to deliver your enemies to you. Your camp must be holy, so that he will not see among you anything indecent and turn away from you. Now, thankfully, as indoor plumbing became common in public places, people started reading this passage in its historical context, and now we don't have to use outhouses on Sunday mornings. Thank goodness, right? Now, while this is a funny example of how a static reading of the Bible doesn't always serve us well, there are others that have caused great harm. In the 1840s through the 1860s, many Christians in the South were staunchly opposed to the idea of ending chattel slavery in America. They built an entire culture and way of life around this dehumanizing institution and could not imagine a world without it. Many pastors, leaders, and laity insisted on a literal reading of passages like Ephesians 6, 5 through 8, to argue that slavery was not only acceptable, but part of God's design for the social order. Now, those verses say, slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eyes are on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Now, fortunately, with the transformation of American culture over time, most Christians came to repudiate the evils of slavery and to see these passages not as literal and infallible words of God, but as part of the ancient culture in which they were written. Now, we also see an overly simplistic reading of passages like 1 Corinthians 14, 34 through 35. They were used to harm women, including me. That says, women should be silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but should be subordinate, as the law also says. If there is something they want to learn, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. Now, for centuries up to the present day, people have insisted that these are the infallible words of God and that women should not be pastors or leaders in the church, my own story included. I had a Sunday school teacher who once said, after quoting this verse, that if there was a woman who thought she was being called to the ministry, she was making it up. I heard those words and I began to wonder if I was making up the call I felt from God. Those words haunted me, keeping me from fully living into my call for many, many years. Now, thankfully, many Christian denominations, including the United Methodist Church, came to see these kinds of passages not as divinely inspired prohibitions, but as part of the patriarchal culture of the ancient world, thereby opening the possibility of female ordination. Today, we have many women pastors who faithfully lead congregations in service to the mission of Jesus Christ. Now, these examples show how our interpretation of the Bible changes through time. Throughout Christian history, various groups in the church have argued for a particular interpretation of a biblical passage, but after more prayer, reflection, discussion, discipleship, and ministry, sometimes through multiple generations, a more faithful reading is discerned. A more faithful reading. Now, what does that mean? Well, for one thing, it requires that we pay attention to the entirety of the passage, not just bits and pieces, cherry picking, as some like to refer to it. We don't just pull out one or two verses out of their own context and then try to apply it to a situation. Another thing a faithful reading means is that we see the Bible, as Mo pointed out, as a library. On one level, it is one book, Genesis to Revelation. But on a much deeper level, it's a library of books, each meant to be read on their own, from their own perspective and within their own genre. We can't read the Psalms the same way that we read First Chronicles, just like we wouldn't read poems by Robert Frost the same way we might read a history book on the Revolutionary War. Now, the cool part about the Bible, though, is that all together, it tells the story of one people, the people of God, and of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So while it is a library of many books, all of the books work together to tell one story. But because those books are written by different people during different times in history and are different kinds of books, the history, context, genre, culture, era, and so on are very important if one intends to read faithfully the written word passed down to us. Learning more about cultures and contexts and history often lead to those new interpretations of the text, like the ones that I gave as examples. And this new understanding, it often moves away from this static literalism, and it seeks to discern the spirit of the text and what it might mean for people today. And it's not unusual when this happens. When this has happened over the years, for those who disagree, to say that those engaging in this work are undermining the authority of Scripture. They're corrupting authentic Christianity. And much of that conflict centers around our Scripture verses for today. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17. Richard read that for us earlier. All Scripture is inspired by God. Or you might be more familiar with the NIV translation. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. Now, a faithful reading of this scripture brings up an important question. What is meant by inspired or God-breathed, as the NIV says? Now, the Greek word that's used there, it's a very interesting one. This is the only place in the entire New Testament that that word is used. In fact, it's one of the only places that that word shows up anywhere. For that reason, it's believed that Paul made the word up, that he didn't have what he needed, so he made up a word when he wrote this letter to Timothy. Now, Timothy, he was Paul's son in the faith. Paul first met Timothy during his second missionary journey. Acts 16, 1 through 3 tells us that Paul met Timothy in Lystra. Timothy was a young disciple whose mother was a Jewish believer and whose father was a Greek. And Paul was so impressed with Timothy's faith and his reputation among the local believers that he chose Timothy to accompany him on his missionary travels. And this marked the beginning of their very close working relationship and Timothy's very significant role in the early Christian church. 2 Timothy, this letter that these verses come out of, is believed to be one of the last things that Paul ever wrote before his death. He knew he was going to die. He was martyred, we believe, in Rome around 64 to 68 AD. And so this letter written to Timothy is like Paul's last will and testament. Now, when you know that, when you give this letter a faithful reading and know the history and you know the context, reading this letter takes on a new meaning. You can hear in it almost the desperation in Paul's voice. You can hear that Paul is saying all of the things to Timothy that he knows he won't get to say to him in person. He's encouraging Timothy. He's telling him to be strong in his faith, to do those things to which he's been called. He's passing the baton on to Timothy, giving him instructions as to how to carry on now. And in this particular section of the letter, Paul reminds Timothy of all that Paul himself has gone through, the persecutions, the sufferings, the betrayals, and how the Lord has rescued him. And he says then to Timothy, "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus." And then Paul continues with our verses for today. He's imploring Timothy to remember who he is, to remember from where he comes, and to remember what he knows. Because, Paul states, all scripture is, are you ready for this word? Theopneustis. It's a mouthful. Now, apparently, there was no Greek word, no word in the Greek language that said what Paul wanted to say to Timothy, to express what he believed about all of Scripture. And keep in mind that when Paul says sacred writings in Scripture, what he means is what we know as the Old Testament, or at least most of it. The New Testament wasn't around yet. So this word that Paul made up is an adjective. It's describing all Scripture. And it's made up of three Greek words. The first one is thea, meaning God. The second is the pneus, meaning breathe, and the third is tos, and that means something that is done by God. So this word literally means breathed by God. Paul says all scripture is breathed by God. So let's consider some other places where God's breath does something. Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the name became a living being. God breathes into the man, giving him life. Ezekiel 2, that tells the story of those dry bones coming to life after the breath comes into them. And then John 20, verse 22, when Jesus had said this, he breathed into them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Jesus breathes into the disciples the Holy Spirit. So we have a history of God's breath doing something. But this phrase, God breathes, is obviously metaphorical. God doesn't have a literal body with lungs and therefore doesn't literally breathe like we do, taking air in and out. To associate breathing with God is to engage in what's called anthropomorphism, another big word for us today, which means to attribute human qualities to God so we can better understand what is the mystery of God. So what Paul was trying to communicate to Timothy, I mean, we obviously can't know for sure, but using clues from other places that talk about God's breath, we see that God's breath brings life. God's breath brings about transformation, transforming people from an old way to a new way. That's what Paul, I think, is saying to Timothy about the scripture. These sacred writings that Timothy has known all his life, these writings, they are useful. They are profitable to teach us what is true, to make us realize what is wrong in our lives, to correct us when we are wrong, helping us improve our lives and our character. And they teach us to do what is right. The words of Scripture were breathed by God. They were inspired by God. God moved in the hearts and the minds of the biblical authors thousands upon thousands of years ago, prompting them to record important stories in the life of God's people. God breathed into their hearts and their minds, bringing to life a desire to record what God was revealing. And in the same way, when we read the Bible prayerfully with other Christians, God breathes into our hearts and minds, making the words of Scripture come alive in us. In this way, God inspires us to be more like Jesus and transforms us from the inside out. Connecting the inspiration of Scripture with the renewing power of God's grace is what seems to have been most important to our founder, John Wesley. Rather than focusing on exactly how God inspired the writers of the Scriptures, he emphasized how God works through Scripture to awaken us to our spiritual corruption and guide our spiritual transformation. When describing this transformation, he insisted that the Bible should be the constant rule of all our tempers, all our words, and all our actions. Now, consequently, the more faithfully we read Scripture, the more God transforms us into the image of Christ. And the more we are transformed into the image of Christ, the more faithfully we read Scripture. Now, this is the true test of our faith, including how we understand the authority of the Bible. Does it make us more like Jesus? Does it more deeply reshape our hearts and our minds according to the law of love? Instead of forcing our agenda on the Bible, trying to squeeze it for a single infallible meaning, we can surrender our addiction to certainty and open our hearts to the work that God wants to do in us as we ponder Scripture. When was the last time you heard God speak through the Bible? How has God moved through your reading of Scripture to make you more gracious, loving, and forgiving? How has meditating on Scripture awakened you to the presence of the living God and rooted you more deeply in peace, love, and joy in the Holy Spirit? You see, as wonderful as Scripture is, reading it is not an end in itself. It is given to us to heighten our awareness of ourselves in relation to God. Because the Bible is the living Word of God. It isn't static. It's dynamic. It's alive and it's active. As Wesleyans, we believe the Bible is both the source of our faith and the measure of our spiritual authenticity. John Wesley taught that the Bible is the most basic authority for determining Christian faith and practice, and it's an essential part of our United Methodist doctrine. Much of it is rooted in Scripture. For this reason, because he held it in such high regard, reading Scripture both alone and with a group was one of the means of grace or spiritual practices Wesley held in high regard. But as we talked last week, the purpose of spiritual practices was not just to check the boxes off each day. The purpose was for transformation. All Scripture is breathed by God, Paul told Timothy. It is alive with God's breath, living and active. It still speaks to us today if we will take the time to give it a faithful reading, allowing it to transform us, making us more like Jesus. Let's pray. Holy and gracious God, we thank you today for the gift of your scriptures, the words that you breathed, the way that you inspired so many authors so long ago to write down the stories of the ways that you were working in your people. We're thankful for the opportunity we have today to study it, to read it, to learn more about the people who were actually living those stories. And we're so very thankful for the way that we still see this living word working in our lives today, teaching us, showing us when we're wrong, helping us become more and more like you, showing us how to live right so that we can love the world, so that we can transform the world, so that we can become more and more like Jesus, your Son, in whose name we pray all of these things. Amen.
So I like to think of reading scripture like, you know you're getting somewhere when you read it again, maybe even years later, and you're like, it's almost like baking something, right? You know, we try to bake a cake and we have all the ingredients the first time, but it doesn't turn out the right way. Yeah? And then we try again and we keep trying and we keep trying, and then all of a sudden you're like, I got it. And that's how I feel about when I read scripture. It's you know, it's not something that you just read. It's not a one and done. You got to keep working, keep seeking, keep asking. So we're going to close with Word of God Speak. If you would please stand and sing with my good friends up here.
Last thing I need is to be heard.
I have a benediction for us today, written again from the Reverend Nelson Cohen. From generation to generation, the scriptures have been proclaimed. Beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Words of teaching, of reproof, of correction. Words of training, words of equipping, words of transformation. Go forth from this place, commissioned by Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, who perfectly embodied these words of life, that we may go and do likewise. Amen.
God's people said, amen. Amen. I hope you have a blessed Sunday. I hope you have a wonderful week. And see you for lunch.